Blackstone Publishing presents Some Die Eloquent by Catherine Aird. This book is read by Derek Perkins. For Sylvia Cox and Nora Mallet, Scylla and Charybdis of my syntax, with love. Some die eloquent, some die wholly in half a breath, some give trouble for half a year. A Deathbed by Rudyard Kipling. Chapter 1. It was a very long time indeed since Detective Inspector C.D. Sloan of the Criminal Investigation Department of the Berebury Division of the Calleshire County Police Force had felt such a fish out of water. It was an unusual experience for him. There are very few situations in daily and professional life which find your fully-fledged police inspector at a real disadvantage. In the nature of things, by the time a man has reached that particular rank, working experience alone has made him ready and confident for the holding of rule, and life itself has taught him not only his own place in the world, but that such niches come in all sizes. Actually, it was his place in the world at this particular moment that was the whole trouble with Detective Inspector Sloan. Whatever his rightful position in the cosmos was on a normal Tuesday afternoon, on duty probably, and very much for preference, he didn't really want to be where he happened to be now. Moreover, for a man whose collar had given up feeling tight in tricky situations a long time ago, who knew what to do with his hands, and who wasn't conspicuously large for a policeman, he was feeling very uncomfortable. He had known beforehand that he would, and had said as much. It had done him no good at all. "It's not a lot to ask, is it?" his wife, Margaret, had said to that. "No. One afternoon. I could make a start on the decorating," he had offered, instead. The corners of his wife's mouth had twitched at the very idea. "The back bedroom's got to be done," he had said.
"It'll get done," Margaret Sloan had replied serenely.
Before... He had tried another tack. "There's a villain, yes? I've been keeping him under observation.
Have you?
All the week."
"Well?
He might try something on Tuesday.
In the middle of the afternoon?"
"He doesn't like night work."
"But,"
her mouth twitched again,
"he does like Tuesdays.
You never know."
"And now,"
his wife had pronounced sweetly,
"you never will know, will you?"
He had given in meekly enough after that at the time, but now that he was here, he didn't feel any better about it. Accidents and incidents, charge room and courtroom, cottage and castle, had found the man unperturbed, his savoir-faire unshaken. But this was different.
"Of course," said Margaret Sloan, leading the way, "if you're afraid of hospitals."
Sloan wasn't afraid of hospitals. He was even familiar with this one, the Berebury District General Hospital. Well, with certain parts of it, that is. All policemen got to know specialised corners of their local hospital over the years. The casualty department, for a start, though they called that something else now. As they'd changed the name of so many other things these days, they'd changed the name of that lately, too. Accident and Emergency Department, they called it now. Not that that fooled anyone. It was still where they took you if you smashed your car up or tried to cut your throat, and where you took the small children who stuffed beads up their noses, or who had swallowed mummy's pills. Or pills. Or detergents. Safe as houses was an expression that never misled an ambulanceman. Variety was the essence, of course. That was why casualty sisters stayed so long on the job. Like station sergeants, they had some of the action, all of the interest, and very little of the routine which stultified lesser mortals. They took on all comers, in fact. And when Sister Casualty, Sloane didn't suppose for a single moment that she thought of herself by any other name, had troublemakers in her patch, she would ring down to the police station. There, her soulmate in office, so to speak, the Berebury Station Sergeant, very soon had someone round to sort out the drunk and the drugged. She had her own ways of dealing with the merely belligerent. Detective Inspector Sloane knew her department well enough. It was this part of the hospital, where he was now, that he had never been in before today.
"Other husbands come," his wife had told him by way of encouragement. That fact had not been a great deal of consolation at the time when she had said it, and was absolutely none at all now. This was because, as far as he could see, there was only one other husband in sight.
"There," said Mrs. Sloane triumphantly. "I said you wouldn't be the only one."
"That," muttered Sloane, "is not the point."
"Isn't one other man enough?"
asked his wife, settling down on a regulation hospital chair.
"Quite enough."
"Well then."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.